Good morning, friends. Welcome to David's United Church of Christ. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. I'm coming to you this morning from Wagnalls Community Theater in Lithopolis as we continue with our Gospel According to Broadway sermon series. Today, we are looking at the Gospel According to Les Miserables. Thank you for joining us from your homes, wherever you are this day. We pray that this service would be a blessing to you. So let us pray together. O God, we gather together in your presence with expectation, hungry for an encounter with you, eager to hear your word. Open our eyes and ears to the presence of your Holy Spirit. May the seeds of your word scattered among us this morning fall on fertile soil. May they take root in our hearts and lives and produce an abundant harvest of good words and deeds. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our teacher and our Lord. Amen.
Another word, Javert, before you chain me up like a slave again. Listen to me, there is something I must do. This woman leaves behind a suffering child. There is none but me who can intercede. In mercy's name, 3 days are all I need. Then I'll return, I pledge my word, then I'll return.
You must think me mad, I've hunted you across the years. Men like you can never change a man such as you.
Believe of me what you will. There is a duty that I'm sworn to do. You know nothing of my life. All I did was steal some bread.
You know nothing of the world. Come with me to 4601.
Now, but not before I see this justice done.
John Valjean is nothing now.
I am warning you, Javert. I'm a stronger man by far.
Every man is born in sin.
My race is not yet run. I am warning you, Javert. There is nothing I won't dare. If I have to kill you now, I'll do what must be done. This I swear to you tonight.
There is no place for you to hide.
Your child will live within my care.
Wherever you may hide away.
And I will raise her to the light.
I swear to you, I will be there.
Challenge you guys to a kindness challenge. So here's what I want you guys to do. So get a plain envelope like this. I already have two already made right here. And then get a marker of your color choice. I choose purple. And then write a nice quote on it, like God bless or have a nice day, stay positive, and I will tell you what that is for in a minute. So I'm going to write, God loves you. And then when you are done with that, like I have right here, when you're done with that, you want to open the envelope, and I am going to put a dollar in it and some change.
What's the change for?
The change is for to weigh it down. So when you give this to a homeless person or a person asking for money, it weighs it down. Instead of, if you don't want them coming up to your car, you can just throw it out there. And if it, you don't have the change in there to weigh it down, it'll just blow away. So you're going to put the change in there and then close it. Just like that. And I challenge you guys to do that. If you feel comfortable, which I really personally don't, you can just hand it to them. But you can keep these in your car anywhere. You can keep them in your backpack. You can just keep them on you at all times because you never know when someone could be there needing anything.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from Galatians chapter 2, verses 15 through 21. We ourselves are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners. Yet we know that a person is justified not by the works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. And we have come to believe in Christ Jesus so that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by doing the works of the law, because no one will be justified by the works of the law. But if, in our effort to be justified in Christ, we ourselves have been found to be sinners, is Christ then a servant of sin? Certainly not. But if I build up again the very things that I once tore down, then I demonstrate that I am a transgressor. For through the law I died to the law, so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if justification comes through the law, then Christ died for nothing.
Would you pray with me, please? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Les Miserables is French for, not surprisingly, the miserable ones, the poor ones, the wretched ones. And yet, since 1862, when Victor Hugo wrote his massive novel, in 1980, when the musical premiered in London, Les Mis has given readers and hearers great joy and lifted their spirits. But its title is not a misnomer. This musical is indeed about the miserable poor. It's not an insult, but a comment on their emotional state. At the beginning of our story, our protagonist Jean Valjean has just been released from prison after 19 years, 5 for stealing a loaf of bread for his sister's starving child, and 14 more for trying to escape. And he can find no work because of his criminal record. But before he is released, the Chang Gang laments, look down, don't look them in the eye, look down, you're here until you die, the sun is strong, it's hot as hell below, look down, there's 20 years to go. I've done no wrong, sweet Jesus, hear my prayer. Already in these opening words, the prisoners have invoked the name of Jesus, but another prisoner responds, look down, sweet Jesus doesn't care. Yet another prisoner cries to God, how long, O Lord, before you let me die? This opening song depicts not only the degradation of these men, but foreshadows the shame, dishonor, and oppression the poor in this post-revolutionary period in France face. These poor scrape by doing whatever they need to in order to survive. Fantine is a young, unwed mother who has been abandoned by the father of her daughter, Cosette. When her fellow workers in the factory find out that she has a daughter and that she pays for Cosette to live with an innkeeper and his wife, they get her fired. Fantine is desperate, so much so that she goes from selling her hair and teeth to selling her body. This is a story about people on the edges of life, those who are left behind by the rest. Constant in the story are their pleas to God. Gavroche, the 12-year-old street urchin, says, "Here in the slums of Saint Michel, we live on the crumbs of humble piety." The beggars in the street cry out, "Help us in our shame, something for a crust of bread in holy Jesus' name, in the Lord's holy name." Faith is constantly appealed to in this powerful musical. Indeed, Les Mis offers up an awesome dichotomy between law and justice and grace and mercy. In the beginning of Victor Hugo's novel, he writes that it was from one end to the other in its entirety and details, a progress from evil to good, from justice to injustice, from falsehood to truth, from night to day, from appetite to conscience, from corruption to life, from bestiality to duty, from hell to heaven, from nothingness to God. The starting point, matter, destination, the soul. The hydra at the beginning, the angel at the end. The hero of this great story, Jean Valjean, is a thief. Thou shalt not steal, correct? But what if it is a loaf of bread for a starving child? What if it is the difference between life and death? This is what we call situational ethic. With his parole papers, Valjean is marked as a dangerous man and can find neither work nor lodging. He begs the Bishop of Digne for lodging, and the bishop graciously provides a meal and a warm bed to sleep. But in the middle of the night, Valjean steals the bishop's silver. He is apprehended by the police, but lies and tells them that the bishop gave them to him. Brought before the bishop by the police, the bishop responds with profound grace, saying, "That is right. But my friend, you left so early, surely something slipped your mind." Giving Valjean his silver candlesticks, he continues, "You forgot I gave these also. Would you leave the best behind? So, messieurs, you may release him, for this man has spoken true. I commend you for your duty. May God's blessing go with you. But remember this, my brother. See in this some higher plan. You must use this precious silver to become an honest man. By the witness of the martyrs, by the passion and the blood, God has raised you out of darkness. I have bought your soul for God." The bishop's unexpected response is an act of such mercy and forgiveness that it transforms Valjean. Certainly, he did not know such mercy in the 19 years of hard labor, and it could be that Valjean has never known such mercy in his entire life. The bishop not only demonstrates God's mercy, but by giving Valjean the silver, he gives him the means to make a new start in life. The bishop breaks through Valjean's hardened and angry heart, and Valjean doesn't quite know what to make of it. He says, "What have I done, sweet Jesus, what have I done? Become a thief in the night, become a dog on the run, and have I fallen so far and the hour so late? And is the hour so late that nothing remains but the cry of my hate, the cries in the dark that nobody hears, here where I stand at the turning of the years. If there's another way to go, I missed it 20 long years ago. My life was a war that could never be won. They gave me a number and murdered Valjean when they chained me and left me for dead, just for stealing a mouthful of bread. Yet why did I allow that man to touch my soul and teach me love? He treated me like any other. He gave me his trust. He called me his brother. My life, he claims, for God alone. Can such things be? For I had come to hate this world which had always hated me. Take an eye for an eye, turn your heart into stone. This is all I have lived for. This is all I have known. One word from him and I'd be back beneath the lash upon the rack. Instead, he offers me my freedom. I feel my shame inside me like a knife. He told me that I have a soul. How does he know? The bishop sees the image of God in Valjean. He sees the beloved child of God, one whom Jesus Christ has redeemed, and he takes action for Valjean's redemption. Valjean is changed by the bishop's action. He rips up his parole papers that have turned him into a number, 24601, and he sets out to create a new life for himself. He changes his name and becomes a factory owner and mayor of a small village. But Javert lacks the bishop's sense of mercy and is constantly on the hunt for Valjean after he breaks his parole. His lack of mercy and sense of how the law must be meted out with no leniency is evidenced when he arrests Fantine for defending herself against a customer when she says, "There's a child who sorely needs me. Please, monsieur, she is but that high. Holy God, is there no mercy? If I go to jail, she'll die." But he responds icily, "I have heard such protestations every day for 20 years. Let's have no more talk, no more explanations. Save your breath and save your tears. Honest work, just reward. That's the way to please the Lord." In contrast to Javert's lack of compassion even for Fantine's daughter, who cannot help being born into her station in life, Valjean agrees to take Fantine's daughter as his own. He has taken to heart the bishop's words that he can become an honest man. The bishop showed him God's mercy, and now he shows it to Fantine as she lays dying. She says to him, "Good monsieur, you come from God in heaven." But none of this phases or deters Javert. To him, a criminal is a criminal. To him, a thief can never change. Of this he is absolutely sure. His worldview is one of absolutes, of certainty. There is no gray. There would seem to be no forgiveness either, only exacting, unbending justice. His comfort is not in God's grace, but in the law. As he stalks in the night, he sings, "There, out in the darkness, a fugitive running, fallen from God, fallen from grace. God be my witness, I never shall yield till we come face to face." He knows his way in the dark, but mine is the way of the Lord, and those who follow the path of the righteous shall have their reward. And if they fall as Lucifer fell, the flame, the sword. Javert is convinced his is the way of the Lord, but he forgets that on the cross Jesus says to the thief next to him, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Javert thinks that following the letter of the law will earn him salvation. Again, he forgets that all fall short of the glory of God. He believes that works righteousness, his own behavior, will grant him eternity with God. But we cannot work our way into salvation. We have to accept it as the free gift that it is apart from the law. St. Paul wrote to the church at Galatia that we know that a person is justified not by the works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. And we have come to believe in Christ Jesus so that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by doing works of the law. Paul is saying here that we are not justified by following the law because we can never follow it perfectly. Though this is what Javert thinks that he was doing. Rather, God sees how impossible the law is for us fallible humans and sends Jesus Christ to accomplish our redemption. Jesus does it not through a new law, but through a new covenant that is founded on God's love and mercy. So it is by faith in Jesus Christ that we are justified and redeemed from any mistake we make, any sin we commit, any law we break. When the bishop tells Jean Valjean that he has bought his soul for God, it is the mercy of God that he experiences. Martin Luther reflected on this passage. The true way of becoming a Christian is to be justified by faith in Jesus Christ and not by the works of the law. We know that we must also teach good works, but they must be taught in their proper turn. We do not mean to say that the law is bad, only that it is not able to justify us. To be at peace with God, we have need of a far better mediator than Moses or the law. We must know that we are nothing. We must understand that we are merely beneficiaries and recipients of the treasures of Christ. Luther argues that we need to turn our focus, and that goes for Javert too, from the law to Christ. And I love this line from Luther, Christ is no sheriff. He is the Lamb of God which taketh away the sins of the world. Jesus doesn't haul us off to prison because of our sin. He takes away that sin and calls on us to sin no more. In one of Javert and Valjean's final meetings, Valjean has the opportunity, if you can call it that, to kill Javert, to end Javert's constant hunting and persecution of him. Javert warns Valjean that if Valjean shows him mercy, he won't show him mercy. He still cannot let go of his obsession for unbending justice. But Valjean does not turn back to his old ways. Still transformed by God's mercy, he says, "You were wrong and have always been wrong. I'm a man no worse than any man. You are free and there are no conditions, no bargains or petitions. There's nothing that I blame you for. You've done your duty, nothing more." Valjean lets Javert go, and Javert will not let go of Valjean. It is the Christian's call to show mercy, even and especially when others will not. This is a mercy openly and freely offered, as Valjean says, with no conditions, no bargains, no petitions. Valjean even says he does not blame Javert. He's done his duty, nothing more. But that's the rub. Javert has done nothing more than duty. He has not shown Christian charity, not seen the image of God in others, only sought out justice that does not care if it ruins lives in the process. The tables turned. Valjean lets Javert go unharmed. But so obsessed is he with the law that this grace is offensive to him. Javert cannot withstand this mercy. He laments, "I am the law, and the law is not mocked." I'll spit his pity right back in his face. There is nothing on earth that we share. It is either Valjean or Javert. How can I now allow this man to hold dominion over me? This desperate man whom I have hunted. He gave me my life. He gave me freedom. I should have perished by his hand. It was his right. It was my right to die as well. Instead, I live, but live in hell. For Javert, though Valjean has clearly stated that he offered Javert mercy without condition, Javert sees it as Valjean having power and dominion over him. For Javert, this is not freedom, but hell. The idea of mercy so upends Javert's philosophy that he cannot go on and he commits suicide. This is the great tragedy of Javert, that he cannot see the limits of the law, that one needs mercy as well. It is tragic that he cannot accept it, even when given to himself. Valjean is not a perfect man, but he has tried to be faithful to the bishop's call on his life. He saves the little girl Cosette from the abusive innkeeper who tries to extort Valjean. He raises her into womanhood as his own daughter and eventually saves the life of her future husband, Marius. As Valjean begins dying, he prays to God to bring him home at last. The spirit of Fantine, Cosette's mother, appears and sings, "Come with me where chains will never bind you, all your grief at last behind you. Lord in heaven, look down on him in mercy." Valjean says, "Forgive me all my trespasses and finally take me to your glory." And together they sing, "Take my hand and lead me to salvation. Take my love, for love is everlasting. And remember that the truth that once was spoken, to love another person is to see the face of God." After having his humanity denied for 19 years as essentially a slave, Valjean was reclaimed by God in one simple act of kindness and mercy that set him on the course of a new life. Valjean was able to love and be merciful when before there was only vengeance and anger. In his love for Cosette and even the mercy he showed to Javert, he was truly able to see the face of God. In the novel, when the bishop says that he had given Valjean the silver and that it was not stolen, he said to Javert, "Forget not. Never forget that you have promised me to use this silver to become an honest man. Jean Valjean, my brother, you belong no longer to evil but to good. It is your soul that I am buying for you. I withdraw it from dark thoughts and from the spirit of perdition, and I give it to God. This is my prayer for all of us. To God be the glory. Amen." Let us pray. God on high, hear our prayer. Take us now to your care. Where you are, let us be in the bosom of your love. Bring us home into the arms of your grace and mercy. Take our hands and lead us to salvation. Take our love, for love is everlasting. And remind us of the truth that once was spoken, to love another person is to see the face of God. That even the darkest night will end and the sun will rise. We will live again in freedom in the garden of the Lord. We will walk behind the plowshare. We will put away the sword. The chain will be broken, and all people will have their reward. Amen.
Psalm 96 says, "Ascribe to the Lord the glory, do the Lord's name. Bring an offering and come into the Lord's courts." Friends, we need your generosity, your faithful stewardship to continue David's United Church of Christ's ministry of love and grace and hope in Canal Winchester and in the community beyond. Whether it is through online giving right now, or through your bank account, or by mailing in your check, we need your support to continue this ministry. We thank you for your generosity, your faithfulness to this community. This month, our monthly offering, in which we especially support ministries that affect David's United Church of Christ, is Q, which stands for Chicago, United, and Eden, the three theological seminaries of the United Church of Christ in the Midwest, located in Chicago, the Twin Cities of Minneapolis, St. Paul, and St. Louis. These seminaries support United Church of Christ theological students' theological formation, developing new leaders for our United Church of Christ. So today, please support the ministries of David's United Church of Christ and Kew Seminaries generously. Thank you for your support and for your gifts to this church and community.
Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See at the portals Christ waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, all who are should we tarry when Jesus is pleading, pleading for you and for me? Why should we linger and heed not God's mercies, mercies for you and for me? Come home, all who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, O sinner, come home. Time is now fleeting, the moments are passing, passing from you and from me. Shadows are gathering, deathbeds are coming, coming for you and for me. Come home, all who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, O sinner, come home. Though we have sinned, Jesus offers us pardon, pardon for you and for me. Come home, all who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, O sinner.
Friends, receive now the benediction. May the Lord Jesus Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness and protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors. In the name of God, our Creator, and Christ, our Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit, our Advocate. Amen. Friends, just a few announcements as we go forward. Thank you for joining us for this Gospel According to Broadway series. We hope that you might be able to join us at our outdoor worship services. Next week, we'll be looking at the Gospel According to Big River, which is an adaptation of The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. It'll be a quite wonderful service. Please join us for that, either outdoors or here online. Also, next Sunday, on August 16th at 3 p.m. via Zoom, is my installation as your senior pastor of David's United Church of Christ. I hope that you will join us. Pastors Dave and Beth Long Higgins and Dr. Paul Kiewit, our former pastors, will be participating, as well as several others. So I hope that you will join us for this celebration. We will continue to have our sit-ins on the Columbus Street side of the church lawn in support of racial justice and equity on Friday evenings from 6 o'clock to 7:30 p.m. I hope you can join us for that. We have a variety of opportunities for fellowship, for community, for spiritual discernment together. We are starting new Agape fellowship groups, which will be small groups meeting together, developing relationships, and just checking in with one another. So look in your email and your dialogue for more information about that and opportunities to sign up. Of course, we continue to have our Monday morning at 10 a.m. lectionary Bible study and Wednesday evening fireside connections from 5:30 to 7 p.m. We hope that you will join us for some of those opportunities. We thank you for your support of David's United Church of Christ that enables this community to be such a loving, inclusive force in Canal Winchester and beyond. Have a blessed week.